So without further ado, let me introduce the first speaker, Dr. Angela Stickle. She's a planetary geologist with a background in aerospace and mechanical engineering, magnetospheric physics, and impact processes on planetary surfaces. She specializes in hypervelocity impact processes and dynamic failure of materials. Dr. Stickle is currently a senior research scientist at Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory. More importantly, asteroid 36986 Stickle is named in her honor. Her talk is Defending Planet Earth, DART, the first planetary defense test mission. So please give a warm welcome to Dr. Angela Stickle.
Hi, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me okay. Thank you so much for having me this morning. I really appreciate the chance to come talk to you today about one of the favorite things that I've gotten to do so far in my career, which is to work on the DART mission. So we'll just jump right in. Maybe if I can change the slides. All right, there we go. So to start off with, why do we even need something like DART? What is DART? The Earth, as some of you may know, is essentially in sort of a celestial shooting gallery. We get hit by stuff all the time. Luckily, most of this stuff is really small. It's like pieces of dust, pieces of sand, small little pebbles. And it just burns up in the atmosphere. We see it as shooting stars, and we don't worry too much about it. Doesn't really affect what we do here on Earth, except to give us a nice light show, right? But occasionally we get by something bigger. And so these pictures, these pictures are from a few years ago, the Chelyabinsk meteorite. Some of you may remember, this was in the news, there's lots of dash cam videos, it's on YouTube, and it was this giant fireball that streaked across the sky over Russia, and it exploded above a city called Chelyabinsk. And you can see here it caused, damage to the city. It caused something like $1 billion in damage, and it injured thousands of people. And this, was kind of startling. We didn't really see this coming. And it, it caused a lot of damage, and so it got people worried. And, maybe you see things in the news, this was a real event, maybe you see things in the news all the time, right? You see headlines that are wild, like, oh, an asteroid is coming. Oh, something coming really close. We have the skull-shaped asteroid that we saw. Recently, we've had a whole bunch of headlines with asteroids that are funny sizes, like size of a house, or I think I saw one that was like the size of 12 giraffes. Coming very close to the Earth. And these are kind of, alarmist and kind of funny. And we see them all the time. But, these don't give us big worry, but we do know that, there are things that do hit us, of course, right? So this is a map of fireballs. So these fireballs in the sky that have been reported by sensors around the world over the past 40 or so years. The different dots, each of them represents a separate fireball event, and the size represents the energy. And so you can see that, we get hit by relatively large things, kind of all over the Earth, basically continuously. And this one right here, this big red dot, that was Chelyabinsk. So luckily, even though these things are bigger, most of them are small enough that they don't cause tons of damage, but we do get hit kind of all over the planet. For a sense of scale, when I say Chelyabinsk was like a big object, we think it was about 25 meters in size. And that is about the size of half of an Olympic sized pool. So if you, think of these giant pools, this is the size of the asteroid that came in and caused all of that damage. So that's really not all that big. But luckily, it's pretty rare that sort of thing happens. But just kind of keep that in mind as we go forward. And so what are these objects? So if you think about space, we have Earth's orbit, we've got the other planets. There's a class of things in space called near-Earth objects, and these are asteroids or comets with orbits that bring them very close to the Earth. So within about one-third the distance from the sun to the Earth, so one-third of an AU, and that's about 120 million miles. So anything that falls in that space is classified as a near-Earth object. Anything, you know, we want to track these, we want to understand them. We don't worry as much about NEOs until they get very close to the Earth's orbit. So the things that we think about for you know, why we did something like DART are what's called a potentially hazardous object. And these are these near-Earth objects that come within about 5 million miles of the Earth's orbit and are big enough that they could actually cause damage on the Earth. They could cause sort of regional damage. And so these are objects that are about 140 meters in size. That's kind of an important size range. And you'll hear me talk about it a little bit later, probably, but 140 meters and bigger that come within very close space of the Earth's orbit. We categorize these as potentially hazardous, because if they were to cross the Earth's orbit, there's a chance the Earth could be there too. For reference, you may have seen in the news recently that we had an asteroid sample return come back to Earth a few weeks ago, and that was asteroid material from the asteroid Bennu that was the target of the OSIRIS-REx's mission. And this white dashed line here, maybe you can see my cursor, under laser. This white dashed line is the orbit of Bennu. So Bennu is actually a potentially hazardous asteroid. We know its orbit very well. It's not going to hit the Earth, but its asteroids kind of in that range that we talk about when we start talking about things like planetary defense. And this is important because there are a lot of these objects. So this is a schematic of about 2,000 potentially hazardous objects that was made by the Center for Near-Earth Object Studies at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And you can see that they're all over the place. We've got lots of them. They've got orbits that you know, kind of are in different places in space. And so they are something that we want to keep an eye on because they could potentially, you know, cross Earth's orbit. Luckily, as I said earlier, a lot of these are very small. So most of the stuff that does cross Earth orbit or potentially hits the Earth is small. It's a couple of meters big. We get hit by things like that maybe once a year. And you know, you might see a shooting star, you might hear something maybe, but it's not gonna really be a problem. We don't know where most of these ones are. We don't care that much. They're not gonna really bother us. Things that are about 25 meters, so the size of the Chelyabinsk impactor, we worry a little bit more. There's about 5 million of these kicking around. Luckily, they only hit the Earth about once every 100 years. And they could cause an airburst explosion. They could cause, you know, building collapse, things like that. And we don't know where most of these are either. But again, they're pretty rare that they actually hit the Earth. Extra luckily, the really big stuff that's in the like kilometers and mile sizes range that could cause, you know, large craters and global devastation, things of the size like the asteroid that caused the extinction of the dinosaurs, they only happen once every 100 or 200 million years. We think there are about four of these and we know where they all are. So that's good. Similarly, the stuff that's sort of Bennu-ish sized, about a kilometer big, there's about 900 of them kicking around near our space. We have found 95% of these, and we find more of these, you know, kind of as we go, but we don't think that there's any of these that are potentially a threat to the Earth anytime in at least the next 100 years, but even beyond that. So hopefully that you can all sleep a little better. The ones that we do kind of worry about, we talk about, and are the reason that the DART mission was sort of envisioned and happened, are the things at about 150, 160 meters, because these hit the Earth pretty rarely, once every few tens of thousands of years, but they could cause a crater that's a few kilometers big. You know, that would cause mass casualties and damage over any sort of large city area. And we think there's about 20,000 of these in the aerospace, and we've only found about 40% of them. So there is a congressional goal that was given to NASA to find 90% of these sort of 150 meter objects. And we're working on it. We're not there yet, but this is kind of the size range that we concentrate a lot on when we start talking about planetary defense and planetary defense activities. All right, so planetary defense. I've said that a few times. What is that? So planetary defense is essentially the set of activities that are taken by NASA and by other countries to find, characterize, assess orbits, things like that, and mitigate potential hazards to the Earth from space. So an asteroid impact is the only natural disaster that we are actually in a position to prevent, which I think is pretty cool. And so the planetary defense sort of set of activities helps us do that. So we have telescopes on Earth, we have telescopes in space, just searching the skies every night, just looking at the skies, finding asteroids. And once they're found, you know, we can sort of characterize them using radar or using, you know, images of the different color of their surfaces to tell what they're made of. And we kind of make a catalog of them. Once we kind of track them for a few nights, we can determine their orbits and we can determine whether or not they might pose a threat to the Earth. So that's this sort of assess category. If they do pose a threat to the Earth, you know, there are international working groups. So the United Nations has a couple of committees. There are other working groups between, you know, space agencies and things like this to sort of plan what might happen. The United States actually has a plan. You can look it up. A revision was just recently released last January about what we would do in the case of an asteroid threat. And so there's, you know, steps we would take. There's different thresholds that we would look at. And it's called like the Emergency Response Plan for Asteroid Impact, something like that. You know, and other governments have these too, and people coordinate around the world. And then there's a mitigation period of planetary defense. And that's what we're going to talk about today. That's most of what I work on. The stuff on the ground. And so FEMA is in charge of that portion. They do exercises every year, every couple of years. You know, what would we do? Similar to like earthquakes or wildfires or hurricanes, they have plans for asteroid impacts. And so they work on that and they practice that. And then there's the active mitigation, the deflection, and that's DART. So DART was a test that was built and managed by the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory for the NASA Planetary Defense Coordination Office. And it was a test of technology for asteroid deflection. DART looked like this. It's kind of weird to talk about it in past tense. It was a relatively smallish spacecraft. The main spacecraft body, the bus here, was about the size of a vending machine off the sides. And these were actually very long. These were a technology demonstration called a roll-out solar array. And I'll show you a picture of it in a little bit. But it was kind of like, it's almost like a paper towel roll. The spacecraft, the solar panels are like a fabric. And the booms here are like a snap bracelet. So, and then they're all rolled up tight, and they just kind of this roll, and then they kind of snap out straight, which I think is very cool. And they were about 30 feet long. So when they were out there, DART had these massive old wings. It weighed about 1,300 pounds at launch and about 1,200 pounds when we actually impacted into the asteroid. We had one instrument on board, and that is the Draco camera here. That was on the front. That was how we took pictures of the asteroid and navigated ourselves. We had chemical engines and also an ion engine that we were testing for NASA, the NEXT-C engine. Smart nav here, that was our brains. That was the computer that did all of the autonomous navigation into the asteroid. And we also were carrying a little CubeSat called Leetcha Cubed. And that was provided by the Italian Space Agency, which took pictures after the impact, and we'll be showing some of those later. So that's it. DART was pretty simple. It was designed to be a very focused test, and we tested kind of a bunch of other things along the way. Leecher cubed was this little 6U CubeSat, so it's about the size of a shoebox. And it had two cameras. You can see them here in this little drawing. And the cameras were called Luke and Leia, because we are a bunch of space nerds here at NASA, and apparently at OSSI. And it, we dropped it off about 2 weeks before DART impacted, and it flew by the asteroid afterwards and took pictures, which was just amazing. We weren't sure what we were gonna get, and we got these stunning images that we'll see a little bit later. And then it sent those back to Earth, you know, over the weeks after impact. So what did DART do? So DART was a test of something that's called a kinetic impactor. And that is just one way of deflecting an asteroid. And this is a little graphic to show kind of what that does. So when you impact into an object at what's called hypervelocity, so you're traveling faster than the speed of sound, a few different things can happen. You can impact and just sort of have an inelastic collision and no ejecta is formed. You just kind of hit the spacecraft and it sticks, and you just kind of push the spacecraft a little bit. The asteroid a little bit. But if you impact and cause a crater to form, it kicks up a lot of debris, and that debris acts kind of like a thruster that gives you an extra push. And so depending on what the asteroid is made of, how hard you hit it, you know, different sorts of things, the amount of ejecta, this debris that you kick up, can change, and that affects your push. So if you're wanting to deflect an asteroid, you really want to create a crater, and you want to create a lot of debris. And so we were testing basically this idea. If you hit, do you get this extra push, and how much of a push do you get? So for scale, I think I said that, you know, the spacecraft here, the bus, was about the size of a vending machine. The whole spacecraft, when the solar panels were unraveled here, you can see just down here, was about the size of a school bus. The asteroid that we hit, Dimorphos, was about 160 meters, this kind of perfect size range that we're considering, you know, we're worried about, right? And that is about the size of like a pyramid in Egypt. So you can think sort of like a school bus hitting a pyramid, and that's like the size of our spacecraft hitting an asteroid. This is what DART looked like before we launched. I love pictures of hardware. I love showing pictures of hardware. So you can see here, this cube here, this is the spacecraft itself. This is when they were finalizing putting electronics and stuff inside before we closed it up. It's really just a box here. You know, it's just a square box. You can see people for scale. These are the solar arrays. So you can see they really are just this kind of, they're just this whopping thing that roll up onto this spool here. Draco here, you can see you're looking up at the spacecraft. And so Draco is here. You can see sort of the cover for the camera, and it's just sort of sitting there on the side of the spacecraft. And you've got a few other things. You've got star trackers, you've got some thrusters around here. But that's, you know, kind of what it looks like. And then right before launch, of course, this is Leecher Cube, our little 6U CubeSat companion. And this was right before launch, the Italian Space Agency, you know, delivered it to APL, and we put it here. And so you can really kind of see, you know, person for scale. It's really this little teeny tiny spacecraft that rode along. I love these pictures. DART launched in November of 2021, right before Thanksgiving, about 2 days before Thanksgiving. It launched on a Falcon 9 out of Vandenberg Space Force Base. You can see here, we were a dedicated launch. We had our own rocket, and here is DART in the fairing, getting ready to be buttoned up. And I just love this scale. You know, this is one of our our spacecraft engineers, and you can just see this, you know, looking up at this small spacecraft in this big fairing, and it was really very exciting. And here it is on the rocket, ready to go, right before Thanksgiving. We launched at on November 24th in 2021 at about 1:20 in the morning Eastern time, which is when I saw it because I was in Maryland still. This was kind of still very COVID-y times, and so we had a big launch party and watched, and it was a beautiful, stunning launch, and it went flawlessly. But you can see here is the rocket going up. So DART itself was a fairly, like as I said, is a very focused mission. Once we got into space, we had four requirements that we needed to meet. And this was done on purpose. We are not a science mission. A lot of the times when we go to asteroids, you know, there's or other planets, there's lots of science we want to do. And we build these amazing spacecraft or rovers to do, you know, really detailed investigations. And DART was not designed for that. DART was designed to test technology. And so our first requirement was to hit the asteroid. We wanted to hit it during its close approach to Earth. And then after that hit, we wanted to create a 73-second change in the orbital period of Dimorphos. And so Dimorphos, the small asteroid that we hit, is actually the moon of a larger asteroid called Didymos. And so it's kind of like a mini solar system. This little moonlet is orbiting around Didymos, much like we orbit the sun. And so we can track its orbit very precisely. And so we wanted to create a period change for it. Then we wanted to measure that period change from the Earth. And from that, we wanted to determine this thing called beta. So beta is essentially a parameter that we talk about that measures how much of a push we got, right? So if you remember that little cartoon that I showed, you have some ejecta, you get a little push, you have a lot of ejecta, you get a big push. That's essentially like small beta, big beta. So we wanted to measure what that was. And that was it. That was our requirements. Sounds very simple, right? Well, we had a fantastic spacecraft team and they made it look very easy. But it was very focused. Oh, wow, that's in Portuguese. I'm so sorry, I grabbed the wrong one. Well, if any of you speak Portuguese, oh, that's embarrassing. This is essentially what I just said. So we launched on November 23rd. We headed towards the Didymos system here. So this is an artist's conception of Didymos and Dimorphos orbiting around it. We dropped off Lycia cubed 10 days before impact. And we impacted into Dimorphos on September 26th, 2022. So just over a year ago. And then we used telescopes on Earth. We had observations from every single continent watching to measure what happened to Dimorphos. Right. So before we got there, this was our best picture of Didymos. We had no pictures of Dimorphos, but this is what we knew about Didymos before we got there. And this was observations that were performed at the Lowell Discovery Telescope and were done sort of in preparation for DART. And from that, you know, we had some idea maybe of what the shape of the asteroid would be, but we didn't really have anything about the moonlet, so we had to make a lot of guesses. But, you know, going in, this is what we knew. And so you can imagine that targeting something that we can't even see, that is just enveloped in that little dot of light going across the sky, caused some challenges for our engineers. There was a lot of testing on the ground of different algorithms and different things with different data sources and types of things beforehand, because we really didn't know what to expect. But that was part of what made it very exciting, and part of the reason we needed a test, right? Because this is basically what we know about most asteroids, is this little dot in the sky And so we wanted to be able to show that we could go from this to hitting it and really prove to ourselves that we had the technology to deflect an asteroid. All right, so hopefully this movie is coming through. These are some images that were taken from DART. And so you can see, maybe you can see this little blue box here. And this is us looking at the Didymos system. So that little dot of light, again, this is a month prior to impact, and this is still the best pictures we had, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, right? But it's still just a dot of light up until very close to impact. And so we targeted it in the sky, and we just, you know, we knew where we were going, and we just watched that dot get bigger and bigger. This is about 2 months before impact. And this is a composite of 243 images. You can see here, so we stacked a bunch of images on it. And this was the best picture still that we had. And again, this is 2 months out. This was the first time that we knew that we really could lock on to Didymos and not just kind of where we thought it was in the sky. And it was still just this little dot. Okay, so now impact day. This movie is very.
I'm starting to see individual boulders on Didymos.
This is us coming in. Unbelievable. The NASA broadcast. You can see we were broadcasting live. So this is us just, you know, a few seconds before impact, and we're coming in, and you see Dimorphos. You see this beautiful surface covered in rocks. We're coming in at 6 kilometers per second, so about 14,000 miles an hour, and we hit, you know, right on target. I can say that there was a lot of screaming and hollering and yelling when we saw those images on the asteroid getting bigger and bigger, and then it got even louder when we saw just that little red image come in, the partial image. I still get goosebumps when I watch that, you know, a year later. It's probably the only mission maybe in history where a loss of signal from your spacecraft is actually a good thing. But we were just waiting for that partial image, and it was just so exciting when we got it. And I know that went by kind of fast, so I'll have a few pictures a bit closer, but you know, September 26th was a big day. It was very exciting. And like I said, we had a fantastic engineering team, and they just made it look so easy. Part of the reason that it's so amazing is that we were moving so fast, so 6 kilometers per second, like I said, about 14,000 miles an hour, that there's no way that you could have a human in the loop here. So the entirety of this final navigation was done completely autonomously, and it started 4 hours before impact. And 4 hours before impact, maybe you can see it here, this little white dot. That is what the Didymos system looked like to our spacecraft. So we saw this little dot, and we took our hands off and hoped for the best. About an hour before impact, we first saw Dimorphos. So Dimorphos is our actual target. Prior to that, we had been looking at the system, right? We've been looking at the whole thing. And you probably can't see it here, but there is a tiny little thing sticking out down here. That was our first detection of Dimorphos, just over an hour before impact. And so then we could like target Dimorphos instead. 2.5 minutes before impact, we stopped maneuvering the spacecraft. So here's an image of what we saw. This is Didymos, and this is Dimorphos. We centered Dimorphos in the frame and stopped maneuvering and just coasted into impact. 2 seconds before impact was our last complete image, and it's this beautiful image of this rubble-strewn surface and all of these crazy boulders all over the place. And that was 2 seconds before impact. Right, and then that last impact picture was that partial image, and it was about a half a second, we think, before impact. And then we lost the signal from the spacecraft. So again, just stepping through, 4 hours, And then here you can see it maybe a little better. You can see a little smudge down here. And that's Dimorphos. 50 minutes, it gets a little bit bigger. And that is actually when we switched our targeting from Didymos to Dimorphos. So we had enough of a view of the asteroid, we could switch the target. And let's get this to go. Yeah. And so this is what this looks like. So we're coming in the final 5 minutes here. You can see here, this is actually what we, the engineer, saw in the Mission Operations Center. You can see here, this is the images that are being streamed back to the spacecraft or from the spacecraft. This is what the algorithm does. It saturates them out so that they can focus on targeting the center of the brightness. And you can see we're coming in and just it's kind of maneuvering to keep it in frame. And then we impacted in the last 2 minutes. This is my favorite picture. 2.5 minutes is our best picture of Didymos. This is our last picture of both of them completely in the frame. If you see these around and you want to know if you're facing the correct way, this is Didymos here on the right, and you might be able to see it looks kind of like a little fish. Here's its mouth, here's its eye, and then it's chasing a smaller fish. Here's Dimorphos and its little tail, and they're swimming to the left, and that's how you can tell they're going the correct way. But this is when we've got both of them. And in the last, you know, few seconds, we really started to hone in on Dimorphos and just see this absolutely stunning rubble-covered asteroid. It's a very smooth shape. It's this kind of oblate spheroid. We see boulders everywhere. And you can see they're just, as you go down, it's just more and more and more boulders. And our final images were, you know, a few centimeters per pixel. They're just absolutely beautiful. If anybody there likes rocks, these are all out on the public. They're, you know, NASA data. They'll be on the Planetary Data System. They're just so much fun to look at. They're just absolutely beautiful. And this is, you know, this is what I like. This is our kind of highest resolution picture of Dimorphos. So this is created from basically 10 images, and you can see that we used all of the highest resolution for all the pieces we can see. And so you can see the impact site really, really well because we got very high resolution there. And then here's the little fish's eye and his little mouth and the fish's tail back here. But it's such an interesting asteroid because it looks similar to some of the other ones we've seen. We see rubble pile asteroids, Bennu, Ryugu, excuse me. But we didn't necessarily know if something this small would be rubbly, and we didn't know, you know, kind of what the rocks would look like, or, you know, how strong they would be, how they would behave. And so it's been very interesting to find that out. We have a naming theme. So different planetary bodies in space have themes for the things that are named on them. The moon, for instance, is scientists. I think Mercury is artists. And for us, our theme is percussion musical instruments from around the world. And so we have named a few different things on Dimorphos. We named the three boulders at the impact site, the three big boulders. So we have Atabaque, Bauron, and Cacabella. Dole is the fish's nose. And then Puno is this little rock here that you under that dot. And that's a reference rock that hopefully will still be there the next time we get to Dimorphos so that we can tell where we are on the asteroid. We will be naming more things going forward. It's really fun to get to name things on different planetary bodies. But we do have a few of the boulders and main features here named. We hit in a very interesting spot. So I mentioned earlier that when we were targeting, we were doing it all autonomously, and they were targeting the center of brightness because that is something you can, you know, program a computer to find. As you can see, you know, only because of where we were in the solar system and in the orbit, only a part of the asteroid is really lit. So we didn't hit directly in the center of the asteroid, but we hit in the center of brightness. You can see here is a zoom in of the impact site. We had these large boulders and we hit kind of right in between them. This shows kind of the scale of the spacecraft compared to these boulders. So these boulders are actually really large. They're about 6 meters big, which is, you know, bigger than our whole spacecraft. And we really definitely hit just right in between them. We did actually hit within 25 meters of the center of figure of Dimorphos, which was just astounding. And within only like a few tens of centimeters from, you know, where we thought we would hit. We came in at an angle, and so actually the things that hit first were the solar panels. So we had these two large boulders, Bauron and Atabaque, and, you know, we came in and the first solar panel kind of clipped into Atabaque, and then the second solar panel smacked down on Bauron, and then the spacecraft itself hit the asteroid. Once DART had hit, a few minutes later, Licha Cubed, our little CubeSat friend, flew by. And so you can see here is an image, a little movie they created of what they saw. So this is before impact. And then you see impact happens. And you can see a big brightening. And that's a bunch of that debris getting kicked up. And it gets brighter and brighter as Licha Cubed gets closer. As it was flying by, you can see, so this is Didymos. This is Dimorphos down here, and you can see this absolutely just beautiful cloud of ejecta that got ejected after the impact. So all of this debris that got kicked up. And so this is, you know, we're coming in to Dimorphos. You can see the ejecta going away. And then they flew by the asteroid and they turned around, and you can see the backside. So this is, again, Didymos. This is Dimorphos, and you can just see this beautiful wide ejecta cone as the debris comes out after the impact. So here is this in movie form. Hopefully these are coming through. So we're flying in, you saw the impact, and you can just see the ejecta. And as we fly closer and closer, and then turn around and see the asteroids fading in the distance. And then Licha Cubed carried on its merry way, sending back data to us for several weeks. This is one of my favorite pictures. This was one of the images that one of our engineers created shortly after impact. And the boxes represent different stretches on the image. And this was, you know, designed to really show some of the structure in this ejecta. So this big bright bit down here, that's the asteroid, and this is saturated. And so this is all of the debris. And you can just see this absolutely stunning, you know, streamers of ejecta going out in these different directions. There's lots of structure. We see boulders in here. So we're ejecting big boulders after the impact. And all of this debris is actually helping, remember, to push Dimorphos. So when we got this image, we were just so thrilled. I study impact craters. That's what a bunch of my research is on. And this is the sort of thing that is just, I find this absolutely stunning. There's so much going on here. It's going to take, this could be a whole PhD thesis just on this picture, the sorts of things that we saw after DART. So Licha Cubed was watching from space, but we were also watching from the ground. This is a representation of all of the telescopes that we had working with us for the DART team. We had telescopes observing from every single continent and also from space, both before, during, and after the impact. We really wanted to understand what the system looked like before so that we would know how it changed after impact. And so we have this wonderful team of astronomers and observers that just worked incredibly hard for the last couple of years, characterizing the system and then afterwards mapping out all of the different changes that we saw. This was actually the first data we got back from a telescope. So about 10 or 15 minutes after impact, we had a Slack for our team, and it just started blowing up. One of the team members from Laurel, from the Atlas telescopes, sent this to the team Slack, and people lost their minds. We thought we'd blown up the asteroid. We were really freaking out. But you see this beautiful, just fast-moving cloud of debris coming out from the Didymos system about 10 minutes after impact. So this was our first data. It was super exciting. And it shows this sort of like, we, you know, if we hadn't known we'd hit, here we knew we'd hit. As I said, we had telescopes all around the world watching. And so we had that first just poof image. But this is some examples from all of the other telescopes. You know, you can see the asteroid and you can start to see this beautiful tail start to form. And you can see it from all around the world. And so we've been watching this since impact from different telescopes and tracking how the system is changing. We were also watching it from space. So the Hubble Space Telescope and the JWST were also observing. And you can see there's still lots of structure in here. It moves around, it's kind of wispy. You see these rays. And it was just really, really beautiful. As time progressed from impact, you can still see that debris, this ejecta curtain, this ejecta cloud kind of dissipating out into space. But what you also see is we started to form a tail. As Didymos moved through space, a bunch of that debris got left behind and recreated this debris tail. And so we actually caused what's called an active asteroid, which was great fun. We had had a big debate in the team about whether or not we would create one. And people didn't really think we would. And so it's been very interesting to be able to track this. This is sort of a new thing that people know about in the solar system. And so being able to watch it from the start and as it evolved has been very exciting. So this is 2 days after impact. And then you can see this sort of evolving and starting here. So this is a sequence of Hubble images. Till about 18 days after impact, you can see, you know, we've got this debris that we kick up, but then the tail starts to form behind as we go. And this just kept developing. So this goes out to about a month after impact. You lose some of this structure from the ejecta curtain, but the tail itself continues to grow and evolve. And so that's what we've been tracking basically since impact. The last images that we got were a couple months ago, I think, maybe a month ago, and it's still there. It's fainter because Didymos is moving away from us, but it's still there. And so it's been very cool to track. Every once in a while, you know, the Slack would pop up and be like, oh, I got another image of the tail. And people have been really excited to, there's, you know, discussions on how long it'll last and what does it mean and how much, what is the what size of dust and things do we kick up. And so it's been very active discussions. This was a couple of months after impact. You can see Didymos traveling the sky, and again, this tail trailing out the back. This was, you know, 5 months afterwards, and again, it's still there. It's getting a little fainter. But I said, we have this heroic team of observers just tracking as it's going by. Last March, still here. And I think, yeah, this is, you know, 280 days after impact. These are Hubble images. And again, you can see this gigantic dust tail that we have left in space as Didymos moved around. So DART is leaving sort of this lasting impression in neurospace, which is very exciting. Like I said, still being watched and studied because we don't really understand when it'll go away. And why, and so people are still studying this. All right, so our first level one requirement, hit the asteroid. Check, we know we hit the asteroid. We've got beautiful images from space-based assets, and we see all of this debris, so we knew that we had actually hit. The next one, of course, was to change the orbital period. On October 11th of last year, the NASA Administrator Bill Nelson held a press conference to announce that we confirmed that we had successfully changed the target asteroid trajectory. So this was 2 weeks after impact. This was much sooner than we had expected to be able to announce this. And it was amazing. This was the first time in history that we had purposely gone out to change the orbit of a celestial object, and we had succeeded. So that was incredibly rewarding, incredibly exciting. This is what we'd been aiming to do since DART was conceived about 10 years ago. And so it was really, really a good day. How did we know that we did that though? So the way that we were actually watching this, like I said earlier, we targeted this system because it was kind of like a mini solar system. And you had a little moonlet orbiting its parent asteroid about every 12 hours. And we could watch that from the Earth using those telescopes. We just saw that little dot, but that dot changed in brightness. So when the little moonlet came in front or behind the asteroid, it gets dimmer, right? You have less light reflecting back to the Earth. So we had tracked that. We knew that really well before the test. After DART hit, we were tracking that again. And so that's this orange curve you can see. So this is the first day after we hit. It doesn't look all that different, but you can already start to see that, you know, the times when the asteroid goes in front of or behind Didymos changed. And after a couple of weeks, they changed by a lot. So we knew that we had actually slowed down the orbital period of Dimorphos by about 33 minutes, which was amazing. It's much higher than was required, but kind of right in sort of the middle realm of what we had predicted beforehand. We also were watching using radars on Earth. So this is a picture of the Goldstone Planetary Radar at NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And for those of you who aren't used to looking at radars, this is a radar image. You can see here, this is Didymos. This is Dimorphos, I promise.
Hey,
and so we could take these.
Angela, I'm very sorry. We're sort of running out of time. So could you please wrap your presentation up quickly? Thank you very much.
Yep, I've just got a couple more. And watch to see, you know, we thought we knew where it was going to be. And then it moved again. So we knew. I thought I talked too much at the beginning. Let me just do this then. So we knew we changed it and we knew we'd measured it. And then we wanted to know how much, and that's basically what we've been doing for the past year, is measuring how much of a push we got. We know that we changed it by 30 minutes, and we've run a bunch of simulations to try to understand what that means. And so this is a simulation that my team ran, and we can, you know, match DART's impact pretty well. You can see here's the ejecta and the rays and things like that. And that tells us sort of how big of a push we got. And so we know that we then can pull out this kind of beta number from that. So we have met all four of DART's level one requirements, which is great. DART has been wildly successful. It's been very much fun to work on, and really proved that we could deflect an asteroid if we needed to. You know, of course, we've published papers and done all the things you do for a science mission. We have this wonderful team of people from around the world who've worked so, so hard. It's been an absolute joy to work with them on this. I've been working on DART for 10 years, and it's just been the highlight of my career. The Europeans are actually going back to the Didymos system in 2026 with the Hera mission, so stay tuned for that. They will be going back to really see what we did and find the crater, and it's going to be really, really exciting. They're set to launch next year. And this is the end. You can, you know, follow along about DART. Mission is over now, of course, but there's a website with videos and images, and you can become a planetary defender yourself. Like I said, DART was a wildly successful demonstration. We proved that we can deflect an asteroid should one be coming at the Earth. And it's just been so much fun to work on, and showed lots of different cool technology. I think it's teaching us still about asteroids going forward. So that's all.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Angela. So we don't have any time for questions. So we'll gather audience questions from the crowd here, both in person and online, and we'll email you them at a later time that you can respond. Thank you very much for your speak. And we'll have the next speaker ready at 11:15. Again, Angela, thank you very much.
Thank you.